scotch. Se fosse no, per chiudere la porta in cima. Ho tolto l'immagine, sarei casinato. Aspetta, però era lì.
Guarda. Se non hai chiuso, basta che dovresti trovarla. Ecco lì.
Fantastico, ok, non so come l'ho aperto, non la chiudo più.
Ok. So this is the last lecture by Enrico who is going to speak about that thing.
Yes. First of all, I have to answer some of the questions that arose during the coffee break. And so actually, this picture is because several people complain about my picture on the blackboard. Well, I was going to blame Francesco, who only endowed me with a two-dimensional blackboard, but since he also has a very powerful computer screen, I can make better pictures. So the main complaint is that my pictures on the blackboard are always too naive because the blackboard is two-dimensional. And so last time I was speaking about graphs that are also cones. And so if I have the structure of graphs plus cones, in 2D is very bad in the sense that I have, say, the cone passing through the origin, and then I look at what happens corresponding to the point plus one, and say the cone passes through here, and then there is a straight line that joins this point to the origin, and then if I look at what happens at minus one, well, there are only two possibilities, right? Either I'm above this straight line or I'm below. Say that I am above. Then what happens to me is that if I have a cone, which is also a graph in two dimensions, well, it ends up being, say, above this straight line and being a convex set. Which means that this cone obviously cannot be an S minimal cone because it's convex, and whenever you compare its fractional curvature with the curvature of the plane, well, both the curvatures have to be zero, but one set is strictly contained in the other, and so there is no way that the cone has mean curvature zero. Nevertheless, this is just a problem of pictures in the blackboard because in more dimensions you can have things like this. So this is, for instance, the graph of mod x minus mod y. You have a cone in one direction, a cone in the transversal directions, but the two cones have opposite convexity. And so, in principle, you cannot repeat this kind of convexity argument for three-dimensional or more-dimensional pictures. Another thing that people asked me, so last time I was almost completing the proof of this result with Alberto Farina, saying that if you have if you have an S minimal cone, which is also a graph in Rn plus 1, and then I was asking the boundary of E to be, I think, C2 beta with beta bigger than S. Then E is a half space. Okay, and so some people said, how comes you are not putting any dimensional restriction? That sounds too good to be true, because we are used to counterexamples in classical case. Well, basically, we only have two counterexamples to think about. One is a sort of Simon's cone, which is a cone done like this. And the other is this Bombieri de Giorgi Giusti surface, in which the Simon's cone, so this you can think it's R8. R8 is the product of R4 times R4, and this is R9. And you have the subtle shape surface constructed by Bombieri de Giorgi and Giusti, so something like this. Okay. So of course a result like this does not. It's an ugly picture.
No, yeah, but since we're talking about picture, I wanted to make a remark. So the Simon's cone, you draw it like that, and it's misleading, the picture.
Because it's rotational invariant.
Because it's wrapping around the origin for every direction, right? Otherwise you could kill it easily. It would never be a minimizer, right? You just chop. So you cannot never separate enough spaces, the origin from the rest of the cone. That's the thing.
Okay, so this is a nice remark. But let's go deeper in Francesco.
Yeah, so it's really, you never can move an half plane to cut the origin outside of the rest of the cone, right?
So you're saying that I could do this and reduce the energy, right?
Yeah, if that's the picture, right?
Right. So, in fact, this is a bad picture because this is in R4 and this is in R4. And the picture is rotational invariant, so I have to think that I'm rotating through here, but I'm also rotating through here. So I don't know how to describe it. Should I put a rotation like this, a rotation like this? It's not really, I cannot really, yeah. Yes, if I imagine it in R3, I can rotate this, for instance, but I should also rotate the other part, and that makes the picture only valid in R4 or more. And that's it. But maybe we have time, let's see if we have time to rediscuss this picture in the fractional case, because Francesco's proof of just cutting this edge will not work in the fractional case. So while removing this triangle here makes obviously the picture gain perimeter, in the fractional case, it's not obvious because whenever you remove this piece, well, this piece speaks with all the pieces, and it's kind of a mess to take into account all the contributions. Okay, but so let me say that this theorem in itself does not rule out the possibility that objects like these two also exist in the fractional case. They are not known, so it is not known that the analog of the Simons cone or the Bombier de Giorgi-Giusti surface exists for the fractional picture. So, but nevertheless, it's not ruled out by this. And the reason is because it's true that in this theorem, I'm not asking anything on the dimension, but I'm asking two hypotheses on the geometry. So I'm asking both that it's a cone and it's a graph. So Simon's cone is a cone, but it's not a graph. The Giorgi Bombieri Giusti surface is a graph, but it's not a cone. And it's interesting to remark that this surface grows to infinity, so and it grows more than it grows cubically. So when you blow down this picture, you in fact obtain a cone. You obtain a cone like this. So if you do a zoom out, basically you obtain something like this. You have the Cartesian product between Simon's cone and R. So basically you have Simon's cone repeated at any slice. I don't know if this picture makes sense. So I wanted to say you have the Simon cone and then you repeat it at any slice. And so this guy is now a cone, but it's not a graph anymore. Okay, the fact that I'm asking two geometric things that are somehow incompatible makes the theorem valid in any dimension. And so, as for the proof, the proof was based on this fact that we patiently computed the linearized equation of the fractional mean curvature prescription. So we said that E was the graph of some function U, and we took one derivative of U, any derivative, and then we obtain the linearized equation for V which was something like this. It was F prime of U of X plus theta minus U of X divided by theta. Times V prime of X plus theta, or let me write it like this, times V prime of X plus theta minus V prime of X divided by theta to the n plus 1 plus s d theta. Okay. I was writing it in two pieces, let's say, with the plus theta plus the part with minus theta. If you prefer, you can write it like this, thinking that you have a principal value here. The fact is that for me, it's easier to write it without the principal value, because when I take derivatives, I want to be careful that I can take the derivative inside the kernel. So I thought it was more clean to write it without the principal value, so that I can take derivative inside the kernel, which becomes an integrable object, rather than exchanging the derivative with the principal value. But I'm quite sure that one can also do that. Now, before finishing the proof, let me answer another question. Ah, sorry, this was not S, this was alpha in the notation. And one question was the following. So, Chavi always says that when alpha converges to one, one should recover the classical minimal surfaces. But one of the main objections that I received is this is not correct because alpha going to one means S going to one half. So somehow, please. Ah, sorry, it's V. Thank you. Sorry, too many derivatives. I mean, V is the derivative of U. And so basically the objection is that alpha equal to 1 corresponds to the square root of the Laplacian, not to the Laplacian, so it doesn't look classical. What's wrong here? Well, I can give you two answers. One is something like a functional analysis answer, that is thinking that the alpha perimeter is somehow related. For instance, suppose that E is a smooth bounded set. This is somehow up to constant the semi-norm of the characteristic function of E in H alpha, say to the power 2, if you want. Now, it turns out that this thing is finite only when alpha is less than one half, in the sense that this is just a Sobolev embedding, if you like. When alpha is bigger than one half, the characteristic functions of a set is not finite fractional Sobolev norm. And this is a possible answer that tells you that one half is already the critical exponent in this setting. This is not completely convincing for me because, I mean, it looks too abstract functional analysis, but I think there is a nicer motivation here because I know that the kernel of the fractional Laplacian is 1 over, say, theta to the n plus 2s, right? So here, it seems that I have alpha, but I'm integrating in Rn, right? So I have to think that this is a sort of Laplace Beltrami written in this way. It's n plus 1 plus alpha, I write it as 1 plus alpha over 2 times 2. So this exponent here, 1 plus alpha over 2, is my new big S. And so when alpha goes to 1, this big S goes to 1 as well. And so somehow alpha goes to 1 corresponds to, I don't know, the Laplace Beltrami on the surface equal to 1. So this is somehow a more geometric interpretation. Okay, then someone asked me what happens when alpha goes to 0. This is a little bit more delicate in the sense that I have almost no idea. So basically, this I think it's one of the main hard things to understand. What happens is that in a sense, maybe nothing bad happens because for most of the data that you can put outside, the sets will like just to disappear or to occupy all the domain at its disposal. So if you have a set like this, for instance, outside, and you ask what is the S minimal set, or the alpha minimal set, well, when alpha is equal to 1, in the classical case, as Francesco says, you go like a straight line. But when alpha decreases, The straight line is not good anymore because we can use somehow this convexity argument and compare with this half plane. A point here, we will see at infinity less mass than the half plane. So this picture is dead. So somehow this point will tend to move closer to the boundary, so to form a set that locally sees more set than before. So I don't know if the picture is clear, but if you have a portion of a set like this, this is the zoom in of this point, this new point. Near this point, you see more set than before. Then far away, you see less, and these two things have to compensate. But what happens if you do a computation careful enough, then you see that if S becomes very small in this picture, it's not possible anymore to compensate the mass coming from infinity that becomes more and more important when S is close to zero. And so somehow, after a threshold S zero, when S becomes less than S zero, then the set sticks completely at the boundary. And so the S minimal set inside the ball becomes empty in this picture when S is small. So this is a hint that maybe nothing really bad happens inside the domain, in the sense that the only bad thing that happens is at the boundary. The set sticks at the boundary, but inside there are no real issues. The fact is that this is just an example. There might be more crazy boundary data. Who knows? That may create other problems. So the real thing that one does not know how to exclude is that somehow maybe the mass of the set is getting even completely empty, but with a small mass, one creates a lot of small particles, which are negligible in terms of mass, but which have a very bad regularity property even in the plane. So somehow what happens is that when S goes to zero, the size of the regularity estimates and the size of the density estimates degenerates. So in principle, this is a picture which is kind of hard to exclude, because when S goes to zero, these little objects are not ruled out by density or regularity reasons. And so one needs a new perspective to understand whether or not this is a real picture and it's actually detecting a new phenomenon in the non-local case, or it's a wrong picture and one can exclude it by a very good argument. Okay. So let me go back to the proof of the theorem. As I was saying yesterday, at this point, the proof of the theorem is essentially finished because U is also a cone. So up to now, we didn't use much on U. We use enough regularity to take derivatives. And we will remove this assumption later on. And we use the graph property. But we never use that it's a cone, so we use it now, because U is homogeneous of degree 1, which means that V is homogeneous of degree 0, which means that I can take, for instance, a big M to be the maximum on the sphere, so of V, and this is actually a global max for V, because if you have any point, well, you just project it on the sphere. V is homogeneous of degree zero. So the norm of x to the zero is just one. And this guy is less than m. And so let's say that this is attained at some point x bar. So if you argue like this, you have that this expression, v of x plus theta minus v of x, if I compute it at x bar as a sign, it doesn't really matter which sign is, but so x bar is a maximum, so all this guy is negative. Now, f prime was the integral function, but it doesn't really matter because, so f was the integral function, f prime was just a positive function. This thing is positive. Now, this is an integral of an object which is negative, is less or equal than zero, but it has to be equal to zero, which means that the integrand has to be identically zero. For all theta, which means that, in particular, since this part is strictly positive, it means that v of x bar plus theta minus v of x bar has to be zero for all theta. Well, which means that v is constant. But this means that the gradient of u is constant, because this is valid for any I, and this means that u is an affine function. And so this proves this result. Now, as I was saying, this result can be somehow generalized, because you don't really need C2 beta. Is enough that the boundary of E is locally Lipschitz. How much time do I have?
You can, well, noon. Noon. So noon, maybe we will start at 5 minutes earlier, right? So,
okay. So, yeah. Okay. So maybe it's worth to do the argument that says that the boundary of E is locally Lipschitz, because it's a general argument based on the on blow up and blow down. And so basically the blow up and blow down results for non-local minimal surfaces were established by Caffarelli, Roggioffre, and Savin. Let me say, if you want to have a compact reading of them, you can also look at section 3 of a paper I have with Alessio Figalli. The idea is basically the following. So suppose that you have E, which is alpha minimal. Oh, sorry. This also was supposed to be alpha. So an alpha minimal set. And suppose up to a translation that the zero belongs to the boundary. Then you can define for any r bigger than zero, er to be 1 over r times e. So you take any point of e, and you multiply it by R. Now, if you send R to 0, this ER will converge to E0, which is called a blow-up cone. And when R goes to plus infinity, you converge to some E infinity, which is called the blowdown So what is obvious is that this E0 is somehow a zoom in of the picture. So for E0, we are looking closer and closer to a point. So we look at the picture. Closer. In this case, we look at the picture from far. What is much less obvious is, well, first of all, that E0 and E infinity are alpha minimal, so the alpha minimality is preserved. And what is very tricky is the fact that these objects are cones. Because you can have nasty counterexamples, so you can have, in principle, a picture which has locally many oscillations, and so when you do, for instance, a blow up or a blow down, these oscillations persist for whatever reason. And of course, one does not really believe that this is a minimizer, but to rule them out, one needs an object which Chavi reminded that was called monotonicity formula. And one of the tricky parts of this business is that these monotonicity formulas are only established with an extension method. So this makes Francesco very unhappy because, of course, a monotonicity formula is something that one should see without extension tricks, right? But no matter what, I mean, the fact is that these monotonicity formulas are very, very precise. So in a sense, too precise to be true in general. Monotonicity formula is something that is so rigid that is already a miracle that works in some cases. And so, but this somehow poses a philosophical problem, whether or not this is somehow the right way to proceed based on monotonicity formula that are so difficult to establish, or there must be another way to obtain blow up and blow down cones and prove that they are cones without monotonicity formula. But this is, I would say, a major issue in a sense. Okay, nevertheless, these cones are useful. Once you know that they are cones and they are minimal, they are useful because they can tell us everything we want to know on the regularity or on the flatness of the original surface. So the fact is this, so suppose that E0 is a half space. Then it follows that E is C infinity near the origin. I mean, there is a small neighborhood near the origin for which U is a C infinity graph. And this fact is the byproduct of the theory of Caffaelli, Roggioffre, and Savin, and the result we did with Begonia Barrios and Alessio Figalli. Basically, the idea is that if E0 is a half space, it means that when you look the picture very close, the picture is getting flatter and flatter. But then you have an improvement of flatness theorem that tells you that if you are flat enough, in fact, you are C1 alpha. And then you have a bootstrap type regularity that tells you that if you are C1 alpha, you are in fact C infinity. Okay, so it's no mystery that looking at E0 gives what happens near zero because it's somehow the right scale of the problem. The other very useful thing is that if infinity is a half space, then E is a half space. This is actually very strong because somehow it tells you that you started with something flat already. And the idea for this is that, again, if the picture from far is flat enough, the picture near the origin has to be flatter. So if you write this in a careful way, you understand that since you have C1 alpha regularity, the regularity that you get near the origin has a better scale factor than the one at infinity. So you are saying I'm flat at infinity, which is an L infinity estimate, then I have a C1 alpha regularity near the origin. So somehow the scales get better and better at any iteration. So you will see that enough flatness at infinity implies that your flatness at zero is already good enough to say that you are completely flat and you are a half space. Okay, this is very good because, as I was saying, you can suppose in this result that the boundary of E is not, locally Lipschitz, I mean outside the origin. Enough to say it outside the origin. I think before I asked the boundary of E to be C2 beta outside the origin, because it's a cone, you don't want to put regularity assumptions on the vertex. And the reason for which it's enough to look at locally Lipschitz around outside the origin is this, that you have your set E, which is a minimal cone and the graph. And so I draw it like this. But it has other directions here, okay, maybe. then what happens if it is not smooth, for instance, at this point? Well, if it is not smooth at this point, it means that in these two other directions, I am not flat. So locally here, I have something like a corner on the horizontal set. But this means that I can now sit on this point and make a blow up around this point. And when I do this blow up, I basically erase whatever it's below, right? Because suppose that I do a blow up here, basically this thing disappears, and this becomes an infinite cone. Then basically you slice it transversely to this, and you just look at this cone, and then you have a cone which is singular at the origin. Now, if this cone is only singular at the origin, you use the theorem that you had before because the Lipschitz graph is preserved and this is a cone which is now singular only at the origin, so you can use the previous version and get that this is a half space. But if this is a half space, this means that the original set was going to be smooth at this point, while you said that it was not smooth. And so this is a contradiction. Then you said, well, the only possibility is that you cannot use your previous theorem, which means that you have another point here. Suppose that this is, again, in higher dimensions. So I have another point here around which I'm not smooth. Well, then I patiently repeat the argument. So I sit down here, and I blow up again the picture. Now, unfortunately, my dimensions on the blackboard are already over, but suppose that you start with a very high number of dimensions. This means that any time I draw a picture, I reduce the picture by 1 degree of freedom. And so after a finite amount of time, I finish my directions. And so this means that sooner or later, I can apply the theorem and be fine. So somehow this locally Lipschitz assumption is nice to have it, and we don't know how to remove it. It's very useful to have something locally Lipschitz because the locally Lipschitz graph is preserved by the blow up, while the class of graphs that are not Lipschitz are a little bit more difficult to treat. So that's why we put that assumption. So with that theorem, we can actually give a very short proof of two results that we obtained with Alessio Figalli with other methods. So the first result is that suppose that E is alpha minima in B1 with the boundary of E to be locally Lipschitz. Then the boundary of E in B1 infinity. Well, and this proof is exactly the one I did before, because it's exactly the same proof. So I can start with my locally Lipschitz thing and look at the blow up and use this theorem to classify the blow up at any point in which I'm not smooth. The second result is somehow the Bernstein-type result. Yeah. Well, but locally Lipschitz means that I am a locally Lipschitz graph. So, when I say that the surface is in some class of regularity, I always mean that there is a direction along which it is a graph with that regularity. So somehow, up to a rotation, I take the origin, and near the origin, I'm a locally Lipschitz graph. So when I blow it up, I get a cone which is locally Lipschitz, and I can use that assumption. The only trick is that to use this assumption, I need that the origin is the only singular point, but I do the same I did before at all the other points, and so up to a dimensional reduction, I can always reduce to this situation. And so I have to be C infinity because of the classification of the blow up. This simplifies the proof. The other proof was cute though, because it was using, okay, cute but a little bit more involved, I agree. So the other result is the Bernstein type result. Let me state it in a strange way. So the Bernstein type result that we had con Alessio, with Alessio sounds like this. So suppose that E is an alpha minimal graph. And suppose also, so an alpha minimal graph in Rn plus 1. And suppose that in one dimension less, things are nice. So suppose also that in Rn, there are no singular cones. This implies that E is a half space. Okay, and the proof of number two is again a consequence of this result. Now you can use, instead of the blow up, the blow down. So you start with a minimal graph, and you take the blow down cone. If you know that the blow down cone is a half space, you are done. So you only have to say that the blow down cone is a half space. Okay, but when you do the blow down argument, then you are basically end up with something that has to be a graph, and you can avoid the vertical parts just by sliding the graph up and down, and then use this result to classify the blowdown cone, which is that the original cone, the original set had to be a half space to start with. Okay. Now, what is the main idea under many of the non-local proofs? It's a little bit hard to convince you in very few minutes, but what I wanted to point out is that in a sense, whenever you can do a non-local proof that works nicely, probably you are taking advantage of the fact that the non-local structure charges you for points far away. So for instance, this is something that we saw in the proof of this result. If you remember this proof, you basically end up with an integral equation, and you are saying you have an integrand which has a sign, and so I get an information everywhere. So in the local case, it would be just a local information, but since you are non-local, this information spreads out. So at some point, I wrote V of x bar plus theta minus V of x bar is equal to zero for all theta in Rn. And this is an advantage of the non-local case, that whenever you have an information, it somehow diffuses everywhere. This is a kind of philosophy that I think is very nicely explained by this picture. Unfortunately, the scan is not very good, but there is a non-local effect that has some nice consequences. And to explain another situation in which this thing works, very quickly, just to have you give you a flavor of an idea which I think is nice. The idea comes from a paper with Ovidiu Savin, in which we obtain the regularity of alpha minimal sets in the plane. Or if you prefer, the classification of alpha minimal cones. In R2. Okay, so don't have time to give the full proof, but the main idea is that one can compare what happens to a minimizer and what happens to the translation of the minimizer. So somehow, one has a minimizer. Let me always draw the naive picture like this. Then I translate this minimizer in one direction. I draw the picture like this. I translate in the other direction. I draw the picture like this. And then I match the boundary data far away, OK? And my size of far away is called R. Then when I do this, I can compute the energy with respect to this R. So I make a translation which is, say, of small order or order one, and I make a gluing at size R. And so I have, this was, say, U. This was U plus R. This is U minus R, just to remember that in this direction, I'm translating with plus a vector. Here, I'm translating with minus a vector. And then I can compute the energy in a ball of radius r or 2r. Now, if you do like this, you can compute it in the sense that we learned somehow how to compute things in the non-local case. And there is basically no precise way to do it, just be patient and do the computation. So in the same way, one can be patient and do the computation and checks that the energy in some ball BR of U plus R plus the energy of U minus R minus twice the energy of U. Okay, this guy is positive because U is a minimizer, so these two things are bigger than twice this. But it's not that much positive in the sense that it's smaller in general than a constant times R to the n minus 2 minus alpha. So in the particular case in which n is equal to 2, the first time we did this, we did it in the extension. In the extension, the computation is not that difficult because U plus R is just a diffeomorphism of U. So the only thing one has to do is to compute the gradient of a diffeomorphism to change variable and so on. So basically, U plus R is U of some phi R of X. I have to compute what? Well, I have to compute the gradient of this guy, square it, and change variable. So in two or three steps, I can just compute this, and then I factor. Exactly, you translate the harmonic extension, and what you have is that you have a common factor, which is the gradient of U square, times whatever comes from this guy and from the determinant of the Jacobian. Now, the first order simplifies, and this is the reason for which one takes the plus here and the minus here, exactly to simplify the first order, because, this phi r is a phi r plus, which takes into account this direction. And so since direction is exactly the opposite of this, the first order of the two will compensate. And so you end up with a quadratic term. And then the R comes from scaling because you have the integral of nabla u square, and which is a cone. And by homogeneity, you can compute that. And so in a sense, this is a way to do this computation. Then we discover that you can actually do it without the extension. This is a little bit more tedious because you have a kernel and you have to expand the kernel. Nevertheless, I think yesterday we discussed how to expand kernels when we spoke about the master equation, right? So somehow, expanding the kernels, one can do similar computations and obtain the same strategy without the extension. So if one does that, it's almost in good shape because the proof ends like this. So I take the minimum and the maximum. N equals 2, okay, C, R to the minus alpha. Okay, it's a trivial step, but conceptually it's very important because when n is large, R is going to diverge, so this factor is going to diverge. But when n is equal to 2, this factor is going to help you. So this is a great advantage of small dimension. And so the idea to conclude quickly, the proof is that I'm taking the sup and the inf of this translation. So if you want, if you're looking at sets, the union and the intersection. But roughly speaking, I will take V, for instance, to be the max, the pointwise maximum between U and U plus R. W to be the pointwise minimum between U and U plus R. And the fact is that it is not possible that both V and W are minima. Let me do a sort of picture of proof by picture because, I'm forgetting about U minus, for instance, looking at U plus. So if I look at the minimum, I have this. If I look at the maximum, I have this. Okay, so if both of them were minimizers, then I would have constructed minimizers that touch at a point, and I would contradict my curvature equation or maximum principle. So in a sense, I have to find at scale one a better candidate for the energy of one of the two. Let's say for V, for instance. So I take some V star, which improves the energy of V by a universal delta that does not depend on R. So I do this at scale one, and then V is equal to V star outside B1, so all the contribution that takes me to BR are the same. And now I just use what is written here. So let's see. I have this. I write it as ER of U plus ER of U plus ER of U minus, and then I think that it's minus 3 ER of U, so I just added ER of U. Then, if I look at the sum of the energy of two functions, or the minimum and the maximum, it's the same, because pointwise the integral will see one or the other. So here I can put V and W. But now I know an information that V, for instance, is bigger or equal than V star plus delta. Very important not to miss this sign. Okay, so this is estimated from below by this. Now, what do I have? So this guy is bigger or equal than E of U. This guy is bigger or equal than E of U, minus 3 E of U, so it's 2 minus 3 minus E of U. But now this guy is also bigger than E of U. But now I reach a contradiction, because this delta was universal, and this I erased the important thing that n is equal to 2. So now this factor here is going to 0. And so I get a contradiction, and I prove the result. So my time is over, unfortunately. But a small sentence to say that this idea of looking at translation is actually useful also in other contexts, because also the universal perimeter estimate that Xavi was mentioning is based on this kind of ideas. Basically, one can look again at diffeomorphism back and forth and compute this object. Now, it's not obvious, but when you compute this object explicitly, you see that it remains from below a sort of volume term. This is somehow the very different aspect of the non-local structure that picks up these small volume terms. And this volume term is taking into account the norm of the translations of the characteristic function. So when you divide this by the size of the translation, you get exactly the BV norm. And this is why the perimeter estimate works in the non-local case and is not known, and it doesn't work in the classical case. So the non-local case gives an additional information, because it picks up mass from everywhere. And maybe with this philosophical sentence, I should better stop and let's go to lunch.